all worked out, but if you want to come, we would love to have you. 1:15 tomorrow and 1 o'clock on Thursday. There it is. There it is. Okay. Woo, I love when a plan comes together. It's a little, yeah. Okay. And then the other thing that I'm really excited about is this Friday, we are having the chili cook-off. So if you would like to, oh, and I didn't get the tickets out. I will get the tickets. So we have tickets to buy in advance. If you don't have them, that's okay. You can come to at the door. You can purchase them for $20. It is a very, very fun event. We are going to be making Taste of Aloha chili from St. Andrew. And so we're very excited about that. And there will be about 10 community groups, churches mostly, that are participating in this event. It'll be at Resurrections Marquee Hall this Friday from 6 to 8:30-ish. So you can come, have cornbread, taste a whole bunch of chili, listen to some music. It's one of the festive times, and we're raising money for our shower ministry for the homeless. So if you are able to come, we would love to have you participate. And if you're not able to come and you just want to buy a ticket as a way of supporting, that's an opportunity as well. A reminder, yeah, Gwen. Ooh, thank you. And an outreach committee meeting on Wednesday at noon, right? So we have that one happening. And then Saturday is Maxine Adams Memorial Service, and that will be at 11 a.m. on Saturday. And then Monday, the 27th. So we're anticipating our next book study, which will be our Lenten study. And that is the book Freeing Jesus by Diana Butler Bass. If you would like to get that online, I'd encourage you to do so. And then we can join together on Zoom at 1 o'clock on Mondays. The per capita fee is there. If you are able to contribute that to the church, just write in the check memo per capita. We would be greatly appreciated. And then now, one last thing. Communion music that we're going to sing, we're going to be doing intinction. So we haven't done this in a while. So I just want to remind you, you're just coming up the middle aisle. The bread is already cut. You pick it up, you put it in the juice, and then you return to your seat. And if you're sitting there and waiting, you don't need to bring your hymnal with you. Sing hymn number 523, You Satisfy the Hungry Heart. So I'll remind you of that when we get there. I just want to give you a heads up before we get there. And now I'd invite Catherine Adkins to come forward for an opportunity we all have, because what's next week? Super Bowl.
So is this okay
here? Yeah, yeah.
Yes, no.
Go to the poll.
Okay. Okay, well, we all know what next Saturday is, and we've been talking about the chili cook-off on Friday. So I'm in the soup mood. So here's my recipe for the St. Andrew Super Bowl of Caring soup recipe. I want you to take all of your despair and frustration and general malaise over the weather, over the fact that the 49ers are not going to be playing. I want you to mix that with just a little portion of cleansing vinegar and a dash of preserving salt. Cork it, let it mull over the week. And then next Sunday, we're going to pop that cork. And we're going to pour it in the bucket, and we're going to mix in a bunch of sustaining dollars. Okay. Those sustaining dollars. And we are going to create this wonderful soup that we can then inhale and sigh over, because it's now going to be shared with everybody in need. All of the money goes to Second Harvest. And we are asking you to come in next Sunday. Bring your dollars, bring your checkbook. We won't be collecting canned goods, but we do want the hard cash, because that goes further. If you are online, write the check, put in the memo, Super Bowl of Caring, and we'll make sure that all of our friends in this community get a little St. Andrew Super Bowl soup of caring. Thank you.
Good morning. Please join me in our responsive call to worship. We are called to bring a new understanding of God, that God so loves the world We are called to bring a new hope in God, that God gives us new life. We are called to follow the commandments and the law. Come, let us be the salt of the earth, the light of the world. Amen. Now let us stand and sing hymn number 510. We gather here in Jesus' name.
Be seated. We gather in Christ's name to be the body of Christ. Soon we will come to Christ's table, but in anticipation of that, it is a wonderful practice to then be in God's light and mercy and share our prayers of confession with God. Let us join now in the prayer of confession found in our bulletin. Sovereign Creator, you spoke all that exists into being. You have made everything for its purpose. Not even a sparrow falls to the ground apart from your perfect knowledge. You alone are the sovereign Lord over all history. Yet we confess that we have little faith. We worry about the same things that the world worries about. We confess that we are often anxious, trying to figure out the future and the plan for every possibility. We obsess over the latest bad news as if by obsessing we can control things. We get stressed over the uncertainties of life rather than praying about them. Lord, forgive us for our doubt and fear. Strengthen our faith to move firmly, believe your promise that if we seek your kingdom first, we will take care of all our needs. Give rest to our minds by fixing them on your sovereign power and perfect wisdom. Give peace to our hearts by anchoring them in Jesus, who has overcome the world by his glorious resurrection. Through Jesus, our living hope, we pray. Amen. Since God has forgiven us in Christ, let us speak the Lord's peace to one another. May the peace of Christ, which passes all understanding and all misunderstanding, be yours today and always. Amen. I will have to say that was very heartwarming and well appreciated. Thank you, choir. That was lovely. We are at the point in our worship when we share our joys and concerns, things that are happening in our lives that we would like to ask prayer for. Carla has the microphone and she will come, and then we can share those so that the people online can hear your request. Does anybody want to start us off? Michelle's in the back.
I ask for prayers to be said for a mother of friends of mine. Her name is Sonia. She's just turning 90, and they finally, after many tests, discovered it's pancreatic cancer. Oh. So she is on her way.
So we will pray for Sonia and pancreatic cancer. Others? Yeah, David.
Thank you. This is in the form of a thanks and an apology. Last week when we had our meeting, annual meeting, I failed in my report to include Ray Souther, who is our resident electrician, and it just inadvertently left him off my report, and I wanted to make amends for that. So, Ray, if you're listening, I am so sorry, but thank you so much.
Thank you, David. Eileen's up front here, Carla.
Carolyn Crocker is homesick today. Just went prayers for her healing.
Okay, Carolyn is homesick. We will certainly pray for her. Anyone else? Was there anybody online? I didn't. Okay. Oh, good.
A dear friend of mine is dying from complications from dementia and Alzheimer's.
Oh.
And probably has less than a day or two left and is at home. And I just appreciate people's thoughts for him. His name is Michael Sarka.
Michael.
He's lived in the area for about 40 years.
We will pray for Michael and for your... Can we hear your first name so we can know whose friend it is?
Mark.
Thank you, Mark, for sharing that with us.
Just wanted to give a quick thank you and a moment of delight to see Dorothy Claw here.
Yay! I had that same thought when I saw her car pull into the parking lot. So, yes. Anyone else? Well, I want to say a prayer for Marcia. She's having a procedure this week, so we just want to say a prayer for Marcia. Anyone else? Okay, let's look to God in prayer. God of wonder, God of creation, God of this moment, and God of light, we are so grateful that you have brought us here in community to worship you and to lift these prayers in unison in your precious Son's name. We lift them, mindful of the ways that you draw us into new ways of being. We can so often, Lord, get bogged down with the things in life, as Catherine reminded us in our soup thing this morning, that it's time that we can lay those concerns at your feet. Just what happens in the news, how long it's been since we've been able to really be together and do the fun things we love. Lord, we are grateful that you have brought us here today to be worshiping you. And we pray specifically today for Mark's friend, Michael, who is suffering from Alzheimer's and is home and is in his final days on this earth. Lord, we ask you, receive him with your blessing, to welcome him with open arms, and to have the transition be one of peace and tranquility, and that those who are missing him and will be grieving him will find your comfort and strength. We pray for Carolyn Crocker, who is home sick today, that you would bless her and restore her to the fullness of health. We pray too for Sonia, who is Michelle's dear friend who has just been diagnosed with pancreatic cancer late in her life. We too ask for your blessing to be with her as she transitions from this light into the light that is your eternal light in her heavenly home. We are grateful for the ways that you have blessed us with so many people who serve this congregation, from the choir to the musicians to the electricians like Ray, who give of their time and share their many gifts with this congregation. We celebrate too those who are returning to worship with us, Dorothy and her family member, as well as Anne Christian as she has returned, and Mary Ellen and her daughter as well. We are so grateful when those who have been away for a while come back and are with us as the body of Christ, especially as we will soon come together and celebrate the meal Christ has prepared for us. All these things we ask in your precious Son's name. Amen.
Please join me in our prayer for illumination, and please note in your response there, it speak to us in clear tones. Calm us now, O Lord, into a quietness that heals and listens. Open wounded hearts to the balm of your spirit. Speak to us in clear tones, that we might feel our spirits revived in response to your holy word. Amen. Our first lesson this morning comes from Psalm 112, verses 1 to 9a, and it may be found on page 563 in the Old Testament portion of your pew Bible. Listen now for God's word to us. Praise the Lord. Happy are those who fear the Lord, who greatly delight in his commandments. Their descendants will be mighty in the land, and the generation of the upright will be blessed. Wealth and riches are in their houses, and their righteousness endures forever. They rise in the darkness as a light for the upright. They are gracious, merciful, and righteous. It is well with those who deal generously and lend, who conduct their affairs with justice. For the righteous will never be moved. They will be remembered forever. They are not afraid of evil tidings. Their hearts are firm, secure in the Lord. Their hearts are steady. They will not be afraid. In the end, they will look in triumph on their foes. They have distributed freely. They have given to the poor. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Our second lesson is a continuation from last week of Jesus's Sermon on the Mount, and I will be reading from Matthew 5, starting with the 13th verse. Listen now for God's word to you. You are the salt of the earth, but if salt has lost its taste, how can its saltiness be restored? It is no longer good for anything, but is thrown out and trampled underfoot. You are the light of the world. A city built on a hill cannot be hid. People do not light a lamp and put it under the bushel basket. Rather, they put it on the lampstand, and it gives light to all in the house. In the same way, let your light shine before others, so that they may see your good works and give glory to your Father in heaven. Do not think that I have come to abolish the law and the prophets. I have come not to abolish, but to fulfill. For truly I tell you, until heaven and earth pass away, not one letter, not one stroke of a letter will pass from the law until it is accomplished. Therefore, whoever breaks one of the least of these commandments and teaches others to do the same will be called least in the kingdom of heaven. But whoever does them and teaches them will be called great in the kingdom of heaven. For I tell you, unless your righteousness exceeds that of the scribes and the Pharisees, you will never enter the kingdom of heaven. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Last week, a member came into church expressing a general anxiety about life, about things that were happening. And then another person chimed in and said, I have sort of that same feeling going on. And I wondered all week about what the source of this anxiety might be. I think 3 years of trying to avoid COVID is anxiety producing. Not being social and supported as we have been most of our lives takes its toll. The political and financial circumstances can set one's nerves on edge. Given all that, I thought maybe it was time to preach a sermon on anxiety. But I think you know by now that I usually don't start with a topic when it comes to preaching. I let God's inspiration speak to me through the passage and then where it comes, where I should be going with it. So I was surprised when the passage this week lent itself to the idea of anxiety and a couple of ideas of how to respond. Now, before we dig into that, I want us to get into that space. I want you to close your eyes just for a moment and think about a time you were anxious. Maybe starting a new job. Moving to a new city. Struggling with a new life problem. Do you have a moment when anxiety consumed you? Maybe you were plagued with sleepless nights, shortness of breath, or unending worry on that mental hamster wheel that you wish you could just find the exit ramp from. How did you respond to this feeling? Do you wish you had more tools in your toolkit to handle this kind of stress? Okay. Come on back. Hopefully you went somewhere and you had a sense of that one of those moments in your life. So I want us to take a look at Jesus' Sermon on the Mount and consider our own anxiety. Jesus ends this section of his sermon with what I would call an anxiety-inducing statement. Unless your righteousness exceeds that of the scribes and the Pharisees, you will never enter the kingdom of heaven. First off, what does that idea of righteousness mean? Do your actions show forth God's justice? Are you moving through the world with integrity and God's purpose? But that phrase, that last sentence in this passage, it would be like me saying to you, unless you are the most righteous person in this church, you will never enter heaven. Do you think that would be a good line to say in a church? Probably not. Now, I want to be clear. I am not saying that. Please don't hear me saying that. God's grace and the abundance of God's love would preclude that notion. Yet here, Jesus is saying this statement to his disciples. Why? Jesus is setting clear expectations about what it will be like to be his disciples. One commentator writes, hungering and thirsting for righteousness is no easy feat. It is an expectation for a certain excellence in faith, a requested resilience in belief, and a mandate for decidedly determined disciples that very well might trouble the faint of heart. Anxiety, anyone? Of course, Jesus does not say this to create anxiety, but like most things we worry about, anxiety is the byproduct, not the desired product. I remember the time during my divorce when a therapist said, well, Anne, you're anxious. And I was completely in denial. I was just completely in denial. I'm like, me, no, not me. I'm not an anxious person. But he gently showed me how my anxiety was affecting my life. Now, admitting my anxiety was actually quite freeing and empowering, so I could respond rather than deny its existence. Now, anxiety often manifests itself because of fear. Fear that I'm not good enough, fear that I will not do it right, fear that other people will think poorly of me. But one of the best ways I know how to think about fear is the acronym for fear, which is false evidence as real. Fear, false evidence as real. Fear is based on false assumptions, which we worry over, and our anxiety makes situations bigger than they need to be, or things that we worry about are actually false and our minds are just working overtime. So what does Jesus say about how to handle these stressful situations? Jesus encourages us to be the salt of the earth, light to the world, and to lean into the law and the prophets. Now, each one of those helps us to move through our anxiety in encouraging ways. Jesus is calling us to be our authentic selves, to shine in the world rather than hide, and to trust in God. We deal with anxiety by being our authentic self. You are the salt of the earth, Jesus said. Now, we know that salt is used for flavoring and preserving food, but it can also be used for cleaning a drain, healing a bee sting, or getting the smells out of your shoes. So Jesus is saying to be your authentic self, embrace your saltiness, and share it with the world. Because if you are not you, who will be? If you are not your salty and tasty self, you are not being your authentic self. Salt is a way of describing your true self. Here's a sentence in a book that I'm reading. It says, you remember my grandma Lydia, don't you? Your great grandmother? I nodded. Back in her prime, Lydia Popper was a force to be reckoned with. Got her salt from her grandmother, she always used to say. End quote. She got her character, her strength, her salt from her grandmother. You are the salt of the earth. Let your saltiness give you courage, embracing who you truly are. You are the light of the world. here, Jesus is encouraging us to share our gifts and let them shine for the world to see. So if you're a singer, sing with gusto. If you're a dancer, you dance your heart out. But if you worry about how you should sound when you sing or how you look when you dance, you limit who you are and you get trapped by anxiety. Jesus calls this hiding our light under a bushel. One commentator writes, the bushel Jesus mentions here is not the measurement that we often assume. Rather, Jesus refers to a vessel big enough to cover a lamp. He describes a light not snuffed out, but covered up. The light is not extinguished, it is rendered ineffective, end quote. Anxiety renders your light ineffective. Anxiety is the bushel holding you back. Bushels can only block out the light when we put them there. So how many times have you been paralyzed by fear? Or when have you hid your light under a bushel? The bushel is our way of self-limiting, of telling ourselves we can't, when in reality we can. And God wants us to shine our light. And once we can deal with our bushel of anxiety covering up light, then we get to share our light like a city shining on the hill. We get to let our light so shine that it shines light on God's love, and our purpose is to fulfill God's light, or is in the fullness of God's light. Excuse me. So you are the salt of the earth. Be your authentic self. You are the light of the world. Don't let anxiety be the bushel that hides your light from the world. And finally, Jesus reminds us to lean into the law and the prophets. These teachings, from the Ten Commandments to the promises of God's love and Jesus's abundant forgiveness, all help us to trust God, to have confidence in God who provides water in the desert, freedom from slavery, and hope in a life to come. The law and the prophets reassure us when we are in that place of anxiety. There is comfort in knowing that God's word was never changing, and it points to God who truly cares for us in our anxious times. And we get to invite God to hold us in our scared moments and to love us when we feel like the world is too big. In closing, I want to share with you a prayer from Francis de Sales. He was a bishop in Geneva during the Reformation. Certainly a time of anxiety. Do not look forward in fear to the changes in life. Rather, look to them with full hope that as they arise, God, whose very own you are, will lead you safely through all things. And when you cannot stand it, God will carry you in his arms. Do not fear what may happen tomorrow. The same understanding Father who cares for you today will take care of you then and every day. He will either shield you from your suffering or will give you unfailing strength to bear it. Be at peace and put aside all anxious thoughts and imaginations. Amen. Jesus said, don't worry about your life, what you will eat, what you will drink, about your body and what you will wear. Look at the birds in the air who do not sow or reap, and yet your heavenly Father feeds them. Are you not more valuable than they? In assurance of God's grace, let us freely give our gifts. Thank you. prayer. Blessed are you, God of creation. Through your goodness, we have these gifts to share. Accept and use our offering for your glory and for the service of your kingdom. In Christ's name, amen. Please be seated. I would ask before I start this for you to open your hymnals to 523, and then we'll all be on the right page when we get to it. Come to Christ's table. May his table be set with his convincing and inspiring words. Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled. Blessed are the merciful, for they will have mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called children of God. And this is how you do justice, love kindness, and walk humbly with your God. The Lord be with you. Let us give thanks to the Lord, or lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is indeed right for you made us, and before you made the world we inhabit, and before the world you made the eternal home in which through Christ we have a place. That all that is spectacular and all that is plain have their origin in you. All that is lovely and all who are loving point to you as their fulfillment. And grateful as we are for the world we know and the universe beyond our knowing, we particularly praise you, whom eternity cannot contain, for coming to earth and entering time in Jesus, for his life, which informs our living, for his compassion, which changes our hearts, for his clear speaking, which contradicts our generalities, for his disturbing presence, his innocent suffering, his fearless dying, his rising to life and breathing forgiveness. We praise you and worship him. Here too, our gratitude rises for the promise of the Holy Spirit, who even yet, even now, confronts us with your claims, calms us with your comfort, and attracts us to your goodness. Therefore, we gladly join our voices to the song of church on earth and in heaven. Gracious God, pour out your Holy Spirit upon us and upon these your gifts of bread and wine, that the sharing of the bread we break and the cup we bless may be the communion of the body and the blood of Christ. And following Christ's example, let us join in praying his prayer, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. On the night of his betrayal and arrest, Jesus took bread. And after giving thanks to God, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, Take, eat. This is my body broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me. In the same manner, after supper, he took the cup and poured out and said, "This is poured out for the forgiveness of sins. Drink of it, all of you. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." And come on up, servers. The gifts are ready. Come. Let us pray. Lord God, in gratitude, in deep gratitude for this moment, this meal, these people, we give ourselves to you. Take us out to live as changed people, because we have shared the living bread and cannot remain the same. Ask much of us. Expect much from us, enable much by us, encourage many through us. Send us out in the power of your Spirit to live and work to your praise and glory for the sake of Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
So the hymn we're singing will be to a very low tune, but make sure you sing the words that are.
Thank you.
Now may our love be like salt that makes life tasty and worthwhile. May our Christian living be a light to those who live in darkness. May our Christian communities be cities of light to be seen from afar as signs that God lives and works in his people. And may God bless you in all of us in this mission, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. And now go and let the light of Christ shine on all you meet, and let all God's children say, Amen. Amen.